So hello everyone, I hope I'm audible and visible to all of you. Please give me a quick thumbs up if my audio video is clear. Please give me everyone a quick thumbs up and welcome to the session number 2 of Quarantine. So in this session again, we will be discussing the 10 must know points in dermatology. A brief introduction, I'm Dr. Cheshta Agarwal, your NEET PG educator on an academy, and I've myself scored All India rank 261 in my entrance examination. Now, few notices which I want to make before starting the today's class, that on An Academy, we have launched a very amazing offer, which is a limited time period offer. Now, for NEET PG entrance examination, if you apply for a plus subscription, you will get 1 month for free. If you apply for 3 months, the 1 month for free. So please apply for a 3 month subscription now. 3 month subscription, you will get a total 1 month subscription free. And please remember, this remains for a very limited period, I guess. This will be only for this month, I guess. So please try to follow all the classes and take a 3 month subscription upon Academy. The next is for iconic subscriptions. Please remember, there's a very special or amazing offer going on. Please give me a quick thumbs up if you can. Just a second. If my audio video is clear, please give me a quick thumbs up. Am I visible to you? Because I'm not able to find it out. Just a second, all of you. Am I audible? Please give me a thumbs up. Yes, very nice. So there's a very limited time offer going on the iconic subscription. Now look at the difference which you all had previously, or actually till this month, we used to pay 92,000 rupees for a 3 year subscription. But now this have reduced to 58,500, which is too less compared to all the other online platform. I request all of you to please use the referral code Dr. Cheshta YT and subscribe to An Academy. This is a very, very discounted rates, which is there only for this month. The referral code is Dr. Cheshta YT. You can take for 1 year, 1.5 year, 2 years or 3 years, whatever suits you. I know we have many students who are in their second year or third years right now. Please take the NEET PG iconic subscription with amazing discounts that provided on the screen. Now we have around 34,000 total questions on the question bank of An Academy. So please try to practice it with us. There are many batch courses going on. One is the Target Next 2022 entrance examination. The batch is starting from 21st of the April. Another is FMG test and analysis batch. It has started on 19th of April. And here all the top educators will be giving you or will be teaching you under their own guidance. Okay. Now, I request all of you to please use Dr. Cheshta YT as the subscription code to get additional discount or to apply for the offer of 3 plus 1 in plus and reduced rates in the iconic. Okay, now starting the today's session, that is 10 must know intradermal skin test. Now yesterday we did 10 very, very important bedside tests. Today we will be doing 10 intradermal very important tests in dermatology. Now, what is intradermal test? These are nothing but widely used tests to support the diagnosis of dermatological and non-dermatological diseases. Now, what is the role of intradermal test? They are indicated for detection of type 4 hypersensitivity in majority, and in few even for type 1 hypersensitivity reaction. Now here both exogenous or endogenous antigens can be used, starting with the first intradermal test, and that is the tuberculin test. Tuberculin test is also called as Pirquet test. The antigen used here is tuberculin, which is a purified protein extract of bacilli which is grown in 5% glycerol broth. Now what do we do? Can you see this? We'll take a 1 ml syringe, which is called as tuberculin syringe. We will fill that syringe with the antigen and we will inject it on the ventral surface or on the volar aspect or the flexural aspect of the fora. Now if we inject it today, we have to read it after 48 hours. And this method is also called as Montoux method or Montoux intradermal test. Now how to read it? Can anybody tell me what is that thing which is measured? Whether we measure erythema, whether we measure the edema or we measure the induration. Anybody can tell me what is measured after 48 hours in a patient of tuberculin test or Montoux test? Anyone? So please remember, you measure the induration. Now if the induration is less than 5 mm, it means it is negative test. If it is between 6 to 9 mm, it means the test is doubtful, which is plus minus. Whenever you have a doubtful condition, either you ask the patient to go for a repeat Montoux test after some time, or you can do some of the other investigative modalities like QuantiFERON gold, which is more specific to tuberculosis. The next is when it is 10 to 15 mm, it means that it is positive. Positive can be because of infection of mycobacteria, or it can also be secondary to vaccination. Please remember, in both these conditions you will have 10 to 15 mm Montoux test positive. And when it is more than 15 mm positive, it can nowhere relate to vaccine. It is because of infection with mycobacterial tuberculosis. So this was the first test, that is tuberculin test, which is done by using the tuberculin. The next and a very, very important test is the leprumin skin test. I request everybody to remember this. Again, few points. It is an intradermal test. Please remember, this test is only used for prognosis or for epidemiological purpose. You will never use a leprumin test for diagnosis. Frequently asked question, which among the following is not used as a diagnostic test, and one of the option provided is the leprumin test. So please remember, all my dear students, that you will not use leprumin test as a diagnostic modality. Now, there are two type of leprumin, or the antigens are of two type. One is Mistura antigen, which is also called as Mistura leprumin. And it is derived from the armadillo. I hope you know what is armadillo. It is the animal source where the mycobacteria can multiply. And the next is Dharmendra leprumin, which is derived from the humans which are infected by the leprosy. Now there are two reactions. Again, a very important question. Leprumin reaction have two very, very important reaction. The one or the earliest reaction is the Fernandez. Remember, F of Fernandez and F of FAST. So it is a fast reaction which occurs within 48 hours, and it tells you about delayed hypersensitivity response to the bacillary antigen. And the one which occurs late, which is called as Mistura, it takes after 4 weeks, and it indicates the cell mediated immune response of the leprosy bacilli. Please remember, this is very important. The Fernandez reaction is fast, which is red within 48 hours, while Mistura reaction is late, which is red at 4 weeks of injection. The later the response, it means that we are checking for the cell mediated immunity. The faster the response, it means we are checking for the hypersensitivity response to that antigen. Now there are few questions I want all of you to solve. Leprumin test is used for everyone. Sindhu, Purnima, Achan. Leprumin test is used for diagnosis, treatment, prognosis, or epidemiological purpose. Yes, here comes the confusion, because you have more than one options which I have told, but if you have to mark one, can you tell me which will be your best possible answer? If you have to choose one, it can be used for both, but if you have to choose one, can anybody tell me, Lepromin test is used for, very well done, if you have to choose one, please choose, it is used for a prognostic purpose. But yes, both option number 3 and 4 is correct. And if the question is, Lepromin test is not used for, now can you answer this question? The Lepromin test is not used for, anyone? Venkatesh, Purnima, Ramu, Sindhu, Ragini, AD Reddy, very well done. So Lepromin test is not used for diagnosis. Please remember, if they mention not here, then the answer becomes diagnosis. It will never use in diagnosis. The question is, why Lepromin test is not used for diagnosis? The reason is, it is based on the cell mediated immune response, that is type 4 hypersensitivity. Now please remember, in lepromatous leprosy, the cell mediated immune response is completely absent, negative. So when the cell mediated immune response is negative, the Lepromin test becomes negative. And when Lepromin test is used as a diagnostic criteria, you can miss the cases of lepromatous leprosy. It can only detect the tuberculoid pole where you have positive immune response, and the Lepromin test is also strongly positive. I hope this question is clear. Another question is on your computer screen. Sindhu Vijay, Abdullahi, Ramu, Purnima, AD Reddy. Very nice. A 16-year-old student reported for evaluation of multiple hyperpigmented macules on the trunk in leprosy, and all of the following tests are useful in making a diagnosis of leprosy except sensation testing, Lepromin test, slit smear, biopsy. What is the correct answer? Please remember, the examination of the skin can be used, slit skin smear can be used, and the histopathological features can also be used, but you will never use Lepromin test as the diagnostic modality. We have discussed just now, no more confusion. Now, Lepromin test is positive in which leprosy? Lepromatous, indeterminate, or histoid or tuberculoid? Anyone can answer the next question on the screen? Abdul, AD Reddy, Sindhu, Purnima, Venkatesh, Ramu, Ragini, Abdullahi, Tejashri, Achan, everyone, good afternoon, all of you, and welcome to the class. Those who are joining it now itself, welcome to the class. Can you tell me the answer? Very nice, Ragini and Ramu. What about other students? So please remember, if you have to choose one, please remember, it is positive where the cell mediated immune response is strongly positive. I hope this becomes a very easy and clear question. The Lepromin test is positive in which? The answer is tuberculoid pole of leprosy. Now, not true about Lepromin test is, anyone? Sindhu Vijay, Purnima, AD Reddy, Venkatesh, Ramu, Ragini, Abdul, Abdullahi, Tejashri, Achan, please try to answer this question on your screen. Very nice, all of you. Please remember, all of you, again the same concept. So can you see the previous four questions are framed in such a manner that they are asking you the same point? I hope you understood why I have given you all the three questions, which is actually asking you the same point. The purpose is to tell you that even the bedside investigative modalities can also have questions from which you can have in your entrance examination. So please try to read them all. So I think we are done with Lepromin test. Come to the third very important bedside investigation or intradermal test, that is called as Frye test. I am sure that majority of you would have not read this, but please remember, Frye test is a very, very important intradermal test. please important please remember, it is a very very important intradermal test which is done for the patients of lymphogranuloma venereum. Nowadays we do not do it because it's very cumbersome and the results are also not that specific, but it was a very important test previously where we used to take the pus from the infected buboes in a patient of LGV. Can anybody tell me how the patient of LGV present? What is the classical presentation of LGV or lymphogranuloma venereum? Anybody can tell me the answer? Achan Venkatesh Sindhu. Please remember, LGV will not present with ulcer because the genital ulcers are transient, very transient or asymptomatic. So patient will never present to you with the complaints of asymptomatic. The main complaint will be the lymph node, which will be enlarged, painful and even suppurative. So please remember, the genital lesions will be transient asymptomatic while the lymph node will be enlarged, painful and suppurative, and this is termed as bubo. Now what do? You take the pus from these buboes, you dilute it with the saline, you sterile it and then you inject into the volar aspect. Can you see this? Now we will inject 0.1 ml of the antigen onto the volar aspect of the forearm. And we will also do a similar test which is called as a control test on the other hand with the help of the yolk sac or diluent in the injection, and we will read it after 48 hours. So this step is, I think, common in everything, the intradermal testing or how to do an intradermal test. Now the reading is done at 48 hours and if you see a papule which is more than equals to 6 mm in size, a papule of more than equals to 6 mm in size indicates a positive result. So please remember, all my dear students, that a papule of 6 mm will tell you that it is a case of LGV, and this test is called as the Frye's test. Very important exam question, try to remember this. Now what are the disadvantages? The test can become positive after the appearance of the bubo. It indicates the infections with even non LGV serotypes. I hope LGV, you all know that it occurs because of the chlamydia. The chlamydia trachomatis type L1, L2, L3 causes LGV, but the other types like ABBAC or D2K can also cause positive results of Frye's test, and that is why this is not used nowadays. Coming to the fourth very important test, and that is Etorin-Sterna test. Etorin-Sterna test is an intradermal test which is done for chancroid. I request all of you to please remember this because both these tests, Frye's test and Etorin-Sterna test, they are not done nowadays, but they are asked very commonly in your entrance examination. So try to remember all these factors. So what is the procedure? Again, same thing. You will inject the injection intradermally, and you will use the vaccine containing killed H. Ducre in a suspension. Now this is a very old picture because I could not found a recent picture of doing a Etorin-Sterna test. You can see that if there is presence of an inflammatory papule of 0.5 or 1 cm, it is indicative of development of chancroid. But again saying, it is not done, it is obsolete nowadays, you will not do either of the Frye's test or Etorin-Sterna test, but I just want you to remember this name. Coming to the fifth very important test, and that is Leishmanian test or Montenegro test. Now this test was introduced by a scientist named Montenegro in southern American states. It is a delayed hypersensitivity reaction which is done in the patients of Leishmaniasis. Now I hope everybody remember that Leishmaniasis, it remains in two states. One is amastigote. One is amastigote stage and another is promastigote stage. Please remember, the amastigote stage is infective stage, and that is why for doing the intradermal test we use a promastigote stage. Now we will make a 0.1 ml of the preparation and we will inject it intradermally. I hope you can see it here. We are injecting it intradermally over the volar area. And if you see a induration of more than 5 mm or 0.5 cm, it means that you are dealing with a case of visceral leishmaniasis. Now remember that this test, that is leishmanin test, is only positive in the visceral leishmaniasis. It is negative in the cutaneous leishmaniasis, and the reason, because the cell mediated immune response is low in the cutaneous as well as post Kala-Azar dermal leishmaniasis. Okay, disseminated Kala-Azar, it is negative. Clear all of you? The Kala-Azar and the disseminated cutaneous leishmaniasis, wherever you have low CMI, I've told you in Lepromin test also, wherever you have low CMI, the test will become negative. And when the CMI is strong, the test become positive. Okay. And that is what is the cycle of the, I'm not going in detail about the leishmaniasis. But remember that the amastigote form, this is the infective form, it enters the human through the vector. And inside the humans, they are converted into the promastigote forms. These promastigote forms will then convert into amastigote and cause infection of the insect. Okay. Now that is about the leishmaniasis. I'm not going in detail, but just have a look over here. This is a classical image of cutaneous leishmaniasis. Cutaneous leishmaniasis, and this is called as a volcano ulcer or Delhi boil or oriental sore. Now, how to describe this lesion classically? Please remember, these are annular plaque with central crusting. Classical description of cutaneous leishmaniasis. Now, this is a case of post Kala-Azar dermal leishmaniasis. What happens 2 to 3 years or 1 to 2 years after visceral leishmaniasis, patient can develop either hypopigmented lesions or multiple juicy papules like this all over the body, which tells you that this is a case of post Kala-Azar dermal leishmaniasis. I hope this is clear. Coming to the sixth intradermal test, that is trichophyton test. Trichophyton test is performed to look for the dermatophyte, which is the superficial fungal infection. It is the superficial fungal infection, dermatophyte. Now, what is the, how to do this trichophyton test? We have taken the antigen from the spores of Trichophyton mentegrophyte. From the spores of Trichophyton mentegrophyte, we have extracted the antigen. And we will dilute the antigen with the help of the normal saline and we will inject it on the volar aspect. Now, if at 20 minutes we see a veal of more than 10 mm or at 72 hours if you see a veal of more than 5 mm, it means that the patient is having a case of dermatophyte or a fungal infection. Please remember, these tests are not done nowadays because there are other modalities like KOH examinations. Even direct clinical appearance can tell you the diagnosis. But we used to do this previously because there were no investigative modalities or infrastructures available in the past. And they are only known now because they come in your exam. So please remember this, all of you. The next is the pathology test. I've seen a lot of students asking questions related to pathology test. I want all of you to please remember this image. I hope it becomes visible to all of you. Please give me a quick thumbs up if the image is visible. Pathology test is a diagnostic criteria for Behçet's disease. Now, how do you do it? Please look at this image. Everyone give me a thumbs up if the image is visible and I am not coming in front of the image. Yes, very nice. I guess the image is visible. So what do? You will take a 20 gauge needle and with the help of the needle, you will insert a 0.1 ml isotonic salt in the intradermal space. But there is a method to do this procedure. The first thing is the needle should be at 30 degree to the skin and it should be around 1.5 to 2 mm deeper inside the skin in such a way that around 3.5 mm of the bevel enters the skin. Please remember, I've seen the questions coming from these measurements. So 30 degree with the skin and 1.5 to 2 mm deeper, you have to inject 0.1 ml of isotonic saline. Now, if you read it after 2 days and if there is presence of an erythematous papule more than equals to 2 mm in size, it means that you are dealing with a case of Behçet's disease. Now, what is Behçet's disease? Remember, it is a neutrophilic dermatosis. It is a neutrophilic dermatosis. What is the classical presentation? Oral ulcers, genital ulcers, they are ephthous ulcers. Oral genital ephthous ulcers, number one. Number two. Three is ocular involvement in the forms of iridiasis, iridocyclitis, scleritis. Fifth is joint involvement. Sixth is skin involvement in the form of furuncle or erythema nodosum. And the seventh is pathology test positive. Now they have given total 10 points. 2, 2, 2, that is oral genital ulcers has been given 2, 2 points. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and then 1, 1 point each. The 8th one is the CNS thrombophlebitis. So total 10 points are given. And for coming to the diagnosis, you should have at least more than equals to 2 points. So very important, remember this point, what is a pathology test, how it is done, and it is used for diagnosing Behçet's disease or neutrophilic dermatosis. So please give me a thumbs up if you understood the 7th intradermal investigation, which is the pathology test. All of you, I know it's a very informative class, we don't have much of MCQs today with us, but I think this class is interesting for all of you. Please give me a thumbs up if you are enjoying in this class. Anybody has any doubt, feel free to ask me. The next is Kevaim-Schlissbach test. This test is used as a test for diagnosis of sarcoidosis. Now in this test, we use, the test can be utilized to differentiate the other causes of involvement of the lungs, skin and the eyes. So what do? You will prepare the antigen from the splenic tissue of a proven case of sarcoidosis and you will inject this over the volar aspect 0.1 to 1.5 ml. Now after 4 to 6 weeks, remember here you have 4 to 6 weeks, you will see the presence of a nodule over the volar aspect. You have to take the biopsy from this and you should confirm the sarcoidal granulomas or sarcoidal histopathology. This is called as Kevaim-Schlissbach test or Kevaim test. Please give me a thumbs up, all of you. I am not seeing any of these thumbs. I hope you all are live still with me. The 9th test is autologous serum skin testing test. Now this is done for chronic idiopathic urticarias. I hope you know what is urticaria. In urticaria, there is degranulation of the mast cell. Mast cell get degranulate, releasing histamine. And histamine is then responsible for vasodilatation, edema, erythema, itching, which is called as veal. Now the question is, why the mast cell gets degranulate? So there are many factors which causes degranulation of the mast cell. Few known factors are infection, drugs, physical agents. But there are many unknown factors and these type of urticarias are called as chronic idiopathic urticarias. Now, in chronic idiopathic urticaria, it is considered that you have autoantibodies. You have autoantibodies which are present against the IgE receptors that are capable of histamine release. I hope you all are following me. What happens in urticaria? You have mast cell degranulation, and this mast cell degranulation can occur because of any cause. There is a very large fraction of cases where the cause is not known, and it is thought that in those individuals you have autoantibodies which have formed against the IgE receptor which causes release of histamine. Now, to detect those cases, we are doing the autologous serum skin testing, which is called as ASST. Now, what do? We take the patient's serum, or we take the blood of the patient, we will centrifuge it, and the serum which is collected is then injected into the patient's own body. Now, suppose if patient consists of autoantibodies, he will respond to these serum particles which has been injected, and the patient will develop erythema and edema over the site of the injection, and that forms the basis of ASST test. All of you give me a thumbs up. Purnima, Abdullahi, Sindhu, Achan, Venkatesh, if you understood this point, very important question. What is ASST? ASST is an intradermal test which is done for chronic idiopathic urticarias where the autoimmunity is considered to be the causative agent. Now, the result is when you develop more than 1.5 mm wheal within 48 hours, it means you are dealing with a case of idiopathic urticarias or autoimmune urticarias. And in these individuals, you can even give that serum as a treatment modality itself. Okay. Coming to the last test, which is the histamine test. Now, histamine test is done in the patients of leprosy. Now, what is histamine test? Please remember, whenever you have trauma, I think whenever you put a stroke, how many of you know what is dermographism? Whenever you use a blunt object and you stroke the skin, you will develop Leves triple response, which means there is dilatation of the skin, there is edema, and there will be burning sensation in the associated areas. Now, what is histamine test? Whenever you inject the histamine, the Leves triple response occurs. But in the patient of leprosy, where there is no dermal nerves, please remember, the Leves triple response, step 3 is not done. I hope you are understanding what I am trying to tell. So what do you do? One drop of histamine acid is placed on the skin, and then you will prick the skin either with the help of a needle or with the help of the scalpel blade. On doing so, you will develop an erythematous reaction all over that area. But if it is a case of leprosy where you have nerve damage, you will not see the step 3 of the the peripheral edema because of absence of or the damage to the dermal nerves. So these are very, very important bedside or intradermal tests which can be done. Please remember, all my dear students, if you understood this, a very, very important question, give me a quick thumbs up if you all have understood this 10 intradermal test. Everybody give me a thumbs up, and after this we'll start the 10 must know fruit and food eponyms. Anybody has any confusion, please feel free to ask. We are done with the test. Now we will do the 10 must know fruit and food eponyms in dermatology. Please give me a thumbs up because it's very important for me to know that you all are understanding, because this is something different from a regular question and answer teaching. Chalo, very nice. Now, starting with the first, that is called as donut sign. What is donut sign? It is seen in the patient of scleromyxedema. What is scleromyxedema? In these individuals, there is deposition of mucine in the dermis. You have deposition of mucine in the dermis. So what happens? Whenever you have deposition of mucine in the dermis, you tend to see thickening of the skin. Now I will show you how does it looks like. Now please look at the image. I hope just a second, I think I can zoom the image as well. Now please look at this image. Can you see it here? This is how the normal skin over the knuckles look like. Please give me a thumbs up, all of you, if you can see this. This is how the normal skins on the knuckle look like. And what happens in the patient of scleroderma or scleromyxedema? In scleromyxedema, because of accumulation of the the accumulation of the mucin in the dermis, the skin become tight. And can you see here? You can see that because of tightening of skin, the folds over the knuckles, it give you a shape like a donut, like this. How many of you can appreciate this? Please give me a thumbs up. And Dr. Kostub, it's okay. We have already completed the 10 intradermal bedside investigations in dermatology. And we have started with 10 food and fruit eponyms in dermatology. So if you have any doubt, please see the recorded session, Dr. Kostub. Okay. So please remember, this is the donut sign which is seen in the patients of scleromyxedema because deposition of mucin in the skin. Please give me a quick thumbs up, all of you, if you understood this. Very important. They can ask you in the exam, where did you see donut sign? So it is seen as a central depression over the proximal interphalangeal joint in the patients of scleromyxedema. Coming to the next question or next sign, that is puty orange appearance. Where do you see the puty orange appearance? Can anybody tell me why do you see the puty orange appearance? Anyone? Dr. Kostub, can you answer the question now? So what happens whenever you have obstruction of dermal lymphatic obstruction. Whenever you have obstruction of dermal lymphatics, what happens? The skin will become like this, like a skin of the orange. And these dermal lymphatic obstruction can be seen in rosacea very frequently. How many of you have seen a case of rosacea ever in your life? Anyone? Dr. Kostub, anybody, those who are doing their internship, or you might have attended the the OPDs, dermatology OPD. How many of you have seen the case of rosacea? In rosacea, you will see dilated pores. You will see the dermal edema very, very frequently. So this is a case of rosacea. Second is pre-tibial myxedema in the patients of thyroid disorders. And in the patients of breast cancer also, you will see the puty orange appearance. So one was donut sign. The next was puty orange appearance. Third is the spaghetti and meatball appearance. I think everybody know this. Where do you see the spaghetti and meatball appearance? It is seen in the KOH mount of pityriasis versicolor. Seen in the patients of pityriasis versicolor. Can you see here? This is how actually the dish look like. These are the spaghettis or noodles. And the balls here are the meatballs. You can even call it as Manchurian with noodles. Okay, so this is a Manchurian with noodles appearance, which is seen on the KOH mount. It is also called as banana and grape appearance in India, because yes, we are majority are vegetarian here. So they have modified it to banana and grape appearance, which is seen in the patients of pityriasis versicolor. And these are the hyphae, these are the spores, which is the meatballs, and others are the hyphae. And what is the causative factor? It is Malassezia furfur or Malassezia globosa species. Clear, all of you? Please give me a thumbs up. At least you can give me a thumbs up, all of you, because I'm not aware like how many are live right now with us. It's showing around 15 are live. But please try to make this interactive. Give me a thumbs up. Okay, very nice. Another very interesting question, that is strawberry gums. Please remember, all my dear students, the strawberry eponym is used very frequently in dermatology. Very frequently used term is strawberry. Now here they are mentioning strawberry gums. Can you see this image? because of the granulomatous infiltration of the gum, it is looking like a strawberry. And remember, strawberry gum is a feature of Wegener's granulomatosis. Please remember, strawberry gums is a feature of Wegener's granulomatosis. We do have many more strawberries in dermatology. Strawberry vagina or strawberry cervix. Then we have strawberry tongue. And strawberry gums we have already read. So can you tell me where do you see strawberry cervix? Anyone? Trichomoniasis, which is one of the differential diagnoses of vaginal discharge secondary to STD. And where do you see strawberry tongue? Kawasaki syndrome or Kawasaki disease. And also in the scarlet fever. So please remember, the scientist or the dermatologist have a lot of affection with strawberry, and that is why they have used the strawberry term very frequently in dermatology. Strawberry gums in Wegener's granulomatosis, which is a small vessel vasculitis, strawberry cervix in trichomoniasis, and strawberry tongue in Kawasaki and scarlet fever. Very nice, Kostubh, Purnima, everyone, very nice. And Kostubh, I think I remember that you are in your final year right now. So here we have introduced a very amazing discount on the Iconic subscriptions. So I request you to please take the Iconic subscription of Unacademy if you are interested, because this will go for this this week, the amazing discounts. Coming to the next very important part, and that is the champagne bottle leg. So how many of you have heard about this term, champagne bottom leg? Champagne bottom leg is a characteristic feature of lipodermatosclerosis, which is seen in the patients of varicose vein. So what happens? Whenever the patients have varicose vein, what do you mean by varicose vein? In varicose vein, because of defective valves, the blood, because of gravity, it remains stagnant in the dependent part. The blood is not able to return back completely from the veins to the heart. So what happens when the, like I'll make this, in normal condition there are valves like this. So the blood which is here, it will never come back. But in few individuals, because of chronic exposure, the valves remained open and the blood tend to get accumulated. Whenever there is chronic exposure, what happens? You have extravasation of RBCs along with that of edema. And this RBCs and edema chronically cause damage to the skin, causing these sclerosis of the skin, and this will give rise to thinning of the skin, and it appears as inverted champagne bottle appearance. How many of you have seen this case? Very important. Champagne bottle appearance, very commonly seen in your in your surgical OPDs. I think I myself seen many cases of inverted bottle, champagne bottle leg in my OPD or my clinical practice a lot. Now coming to the port wine stain. So port wine stain is used for very frequently. Can you tell me in which syndrome one of the triad is port wine stain? Anyone? Dr. Kostubh, Purnima. In which of the following syndrome port wine stain is one of the component? Anybody can answer this question? Very easy. I think everybody knows this. So please remember, port wine stain is one of the component of Sturge-Weber syndrome. I hope you have heard this. What is Sturge-Weber syndrome? It's a classical syndrome which presents with capillary malformation, which is also called as port wine stain. It presents with the seizures, as well as there is ocular features in the form of glaucoma and cataract. So please remember, port wine stain is a feature of capillary malformation. Now why it is called as port wine? Because look at this wine, The color of the skin, it is very similar to a wine which is called as port wine, and that is why it is called as the port wine stain. Okay, and we have already discussed that these stains cannot have complete or spontaneous improvement. It remains throughout the life, and you have to counsel the patient that it will only increase in proportion to the body, and it remains localized to the one part of the face. It will not involve the both part. Okay, so please remember, port wine stain, a feature of Sturge-Weber syndrome. Very nice. Another is sausage finger. Very important. I hope you know what is sausages. Not so common in the in the country like India, where the vegetable diet is very frequent. Now, sausage is somewhat like this. You put it in the bread and you eat it like a hamburger. Now, the patients of psoriasis, because of dactylitis, please remember this term. Dactylitis. Can you see this image? I want a thumbs up if you all can appreciate the swelling which is seen here. Because of the smaller joint, I hope you know that DIP is very frequently involved in the patients of psoriasis. So because of the smaller joint involved, you can see presence of swelling or inflammation all over the digits, giving rise to a saucer finger or a dactylitis like appearance. And when you do an x-ray, can you tell me what is the characteristic x-ray finding in the patients of anyone? What is the characteristic x-ray finding in the patients of psoriasis? It is the penicillin cup appearance. Please give me a thumbs up, all of you, if you remember this. Very important, sausage finger is seen in the patients of psoriasis or psoriatic arthritis because of involvement of the digits. You have dactylitis, and if you do the x-ray, you will see the presence of penicillin cup appearance. Even sometimes sucked candy appearance is seen. But remember, the sucked candy appearance is more frequently used for systemic sclerosis compared to that of the psoriatic arthritis. Now coming to the watermelon stomach. Very nice. I think now this is a season of watermelon. I'm not sure about the other parts, but in Rajasthan, at this time you get a lot of watermelons. Okay. And I think everybody have seen a watermelon. It looks somewhat like this. Now, can you see this image? This one? This is looking like a watermelon. So what is this image? This is a upper GI endoscopy. So when you do upper GI endoscopy in a patient of systemic sclerosis, because of vascular ectasias, you will see a classical watermelon appearance. Please give me a quick thumbs up if you understood what is watermelon appearance. It is seen in the patients of systemic sclerosis, and remember, it is not seen in the skin. It is seen in the GI mucosa, and it is the upper GI endoscopic finding. Now all of you give me a thumbs up. Ramu, Neha Zabi, Nikita, Purnima, AD Reddy, Dr. Kostup, everybody give me a thumbs up if you understood this. And if you want, I can zoom this for you so that, one second, why it is, yes. I hope now it becomes very better visualized to all of you. Please give me a quick thumbs up. Okay, very nice all of you. So this is called as watermelon appearance in an upper GI endoscopy of the patients of systemic sclerosis. Okay, chalo, very nice all of you. Let's move to the next question. Now, B.B. Hansen, I think everybody have come across the cases of B.B. Hansen's. I myself tells you a lot about the B.B. Hansen's cases. Now, if you remember, in B.B. Hansen, there is a category, there is a borderline group which presents with a classical lesion which is called as inverted saucer shape appearance. Now please remember, inverted saucer shape appearance is when you look the lesions from side. Suppose here you have leprosy patch. If I look it from top, it will look different, and if I look it from side, it will look different. So please remember, a case of B.B. Hansen will give an appearance of inverted saucer when it is seen from the side. And when it is seen from the top, it gives you an appearance which is called as Swiss cheese pattern. Can you see there are multiple punched out lesions? So this is called as Swiss cheese pattern of B.B. Hansen. Very important. I hope you have seen this this type of cheese in cartoons like Tom and Jerry. How many of you have seen this Swiss cheese in the cartoons? I think Jerry loves eating this cheese, okay? So yes, so very important, in Swiss cheese you have holes in them, and this holes will give you an appearance of B.B. Hansen's. Another very important food eponym in dermatology. Please give me a quick thumbs up, all of you. Very nice. Now coming to some of the signs. We have already read what is breakfast, lunch, dinner sign. Can you see? There are three lesions together. Here also, 1, 2, 3. So what happens whenever a patient have khatmal bite or a bed bug bite? Please remember, a khatmal bite or a bed bug. Very sorry, I think I have written it wrong. It should be a bed bug bite. So please remember, a khatmal bite or a bed bug bite will always present, the lesions will always present, in three in number, always. And this sign is called as the breakfast, lunch, dinner sign. Please remember this point, this is a very important question, that what is a breakfast, lunch, dinner sign? It is seen in the bed bug hypersensitivity or khatmal bite, where the lesions are papular lesions which are present three in the number everywhere, okay? So very interesting that the khatmal have come to the skin, had his breakfast, lunch and dinner all together, and again went back to the beddings. Chalo. Now cat tongue sign, very important sign. Can you tell me where do you see the cat tongue sign? Anyone? I know it's written in the image, but I just wanted to know from you all. Where do you see cat tongue sign without looking at the screen? Can you tell me that? Purnima, Kostu, Venkatesh, AD Reddy, Nikita. Can you tell me where do you see the cat tongue sign? Okay. So, first of all, I wanted to show you how does the cat tongue looks like. So, can you see? There is the papillae of the cat tongue is very prominent. Just look at your tongue and compare it with that of the cat tongue. Our tongue is smooth. The papillae are not that prominent, but in the cat, the papillae are very prominent. So what happens in a patient of DLE? Suppose this is the skin. I hope you all can see. This is the skin. These are the hairs like this. Everybody knows that on the skin we have multiple hairs like this. Now what happens in the patient of discoid lupus erythematosus? You have thick scale, hyperkeratosis, and thick scales gets deposited, and these scales tend to go deeper in the follicular openings like this. They go deeper in the follicular openings. Now what happens when you remove these scales? When you remove these scales, and suppose here is that scale. When you remove these scales, the under surface of these scales will have tiny projections like this. And can you see this tiny projections under the surface of these scales give you a very classical image similar to that of a cat tongue? And this is also called as carpet tack sign. So both these things are similar. Carpet tack sign or cat tongue sign is seen in the patients of DLE because the scales or keratinization, it causes follicular occlusion. It goes inside the follicular opening, and when you remove these scales, these follicular invaginations will give you a keratotic appearance or a pointed appearance over the under surface. Now please give me a quick thumbs up if you all understood this. This is a very, very important question. Everyone give me a quick thumbs up. Very nice. The next is chicken skin or Moroccan leather appearance. Now if you have seen a skin of the chicken, it looks somewhat like this. And also I think you have seen a leather. So Moroccan leather will give you a very characteristic image like this. So this is a feature of pseudoxanthoma elasticum, which occurs because of damage to the elastic fibers. The skin of the neck will give you an appearance very similar to Moroccan leather or chicken skin appearance. Please remember, again, this is a very important question. And I'm very sorry that the image is hiding the text. Why that is happening, I have no idea. Yes, now it becomes easy for you to read. The Moroccan skin or the chicken skin appearance is frequent in pseudoxanthoma elasticum. Can anybody tell me what is the gene defect in the patients of pseudoxanthoma elasticum? Anyone? What is the gene defect in the patient of pseudoxanthoma elasticum? Purnima, Kostub, Ramu, Venkateshan, Edi Reddy. The gene is ABCC6. Yes. So the elastic fibers get degenerate. So the elasticity of the skin is lost. And when the elasticity gets lost, the skin will give you a chicken leather or a chicken skin or a Moroccan leather appearance. Now coming to the fish scales. Again, the image is hiding. I don't know why. Yes. Now it becomes better visualized to all of you. Fish scale. I think everybody have drawn the image of the fish when you were a kid. So when the patient develops these scales similar to that of fish, it is called as ichthyosis, or it is called as ichthyosiform scales, which is very, very classical of ichthyosiform disorders. Please remember, in these individuals, you have defective keratinization or epidermopoiesis. And because of defective keratinization, the proper skin is not getting formed. And in these individuals, you will develop retention scales. So fish-like scales is seen in the patients of ichthyosis. Next is leonine facies. Again, leonine facies, it is seen especially in the diffuse forms, that is the leprometous leprosy. And look at the clinical image. Because of diffuse infiltration of the face, the man is giving an appearance very similar to that of the face of a lion. Okay. So leonine facies is a characteristic feature of diffuse form, that is leprometous leprosy. Clear or not, everyone? Okay. So leonine facies. Then we have lobster claw deformity. Again, I don't know why this is happening. There's an overlap. I can reduce the image so that it becomes better visualized. Yes, I think it becomes better now. So what is lobster claw deformity? So in the patients of ectodermal dysplasias, sometimes what happens, there is fusion of the digits. And whenever there is fusion of disease, the digits, it give rise to the hands like that of a lobster. I hope you have seen a lobster. It has somewhat like this. Okay, only the two digits they have. And here also you can see that because of fusion of the digits, it give you a lobster claw deformity, which is very classical of EEC syndrome, which is an example of ectodermal dysplasia, where E stands for the ectrodactyly, another E stands for ectodermal dysplasia, and C stands for clefting syndrome because they have presence of the cleft lip. Next is the moth-eaten alopecia. Please remember, the moth-eaten alopecia is a feature of secondary syphilis. It's a feature of secondary syphilis. And you will have diffuse hair loss, which can be scarring or non-scarring, which is seen very frequently in the patients of secondary syphilis. Then we have raccoon's eye or panda eye or owl's eye appearance, seen in the patients of neonatal allele. I think you remember, I've told you in the morning class today that because of transplacental transfer of anti-Rho and anti-La antibodies, the neonates born to the SLE positive patients, they can develop the lesions like this, where you have erythema around the eyes, which is called as raccoon's eye or owl's eye appearance. Is that clear to all of you? Please give me a quick thumbs up, everyone. Ramu, Purnima, Kostub. Then we have school of fish appearance. which is seen in the patients of chancroid, where you have herpes, chancroid where you have Haemophilus Ducre. Now, Haemophilus Ducre, they remain in the groups, and this grouping of Haemophilus Ducre is called as school of fish appearance. So remember that fish always remains in group like this, and Haemophilus Ducre also remains in a group, and that is why it is called as the school of fish appearance or railroad track appearance. Then you have toad skin, which is seen in vitamin A deficiency. You can even see this in essential fatty acid deficiency. Toad is a frog, the same variety, not exactly the frog, but yes, they have a very roughened skin, and in the patient of Phrynoderma, you develop the toad skin like this, okay? And lastly, you have tiger tail appearance, and this is seen on polarized light. Please remember, this is seen under polarized light. Okay, under the polarized light, under the polarized light, you will see the hair in trichothiodystrophy as having the alternate light and dark color bend, and this give an appearance which is very similar to that of the tiger tail. Now, please give me a thumbs up, all of you, if you understood the today's class. Thanks to all the dear students for their patience listening. In the end, I just wanted to tell you that please try to take the benefit of the offers going on. On Plus, we have 3+1, that is, if you take a 3-month subscription, you will get a 1-month discount. Use the code Dr. Cheshta YT for subscription. And for Iconic, please remember, the subscription cost have reduced a lot. Please remember, from 92,000 it reduced to 58,500. So try to use the code Dr. Cheshta YT to subscribe to any of the course on an academy. So bye bye all of you. Take care. We'll meet again tomorrow with another interesting